Okay, so I guess it's time to begin. So my name is Ville Hako-san Sirviö, and I'm going to tell you about the recent bankruptcies of Japanese animation studios and why those happened. And you can use the hashtag Desurapsi if you want to tweet about this. And feel free to ask any questions during the lecture. So let's take a quick look at what kind of studios have been closed recently. So the first example is Trans Arts. It went bankrupt in year 2012. And it's maybe best known for the anime The Prince of Tennis, which is an almost 200 episodes long early 2000s shonen sports series. And then they have also made Kemono no Soja Erin in 2009, and they did it. They made it with Studio Production IG. Okay, so next example is Manglobe. It's perhaps the most notable of these, and it went bankrupt in 2015. It's known for many animes, but for example, it's known for Samurai Champloo and Ergo Proxy, which are both original productions. And I think that's kind of one of the characteristics of Manglobe, that they have done many original works, more than an average animation studio. Then also Studio Fantasia went bankrupt a year after that. It was in 2016. And they made, for example, the anime adaptation of the visual novel Kimiga Nozomu Eien. And also they have made an original work, Soko no Strain. They are not maybe the most well-known studio, but they have been around since 1983. So there's certainly something they've done right, even if you might not have heard about them. And then there's Artland. Well, actually, it's not actually bankrupt yet, but it's not far from bankruptcy. I'll explain about it a bit later. And they are known, for example, for Mushishi anime adaptation and this epic 110 episodes long space opera OVA, The Legend of the Galactic Heroes. And the latest example is Production IMS. It went bankrupt last summer, 2018. They are a rather young studio. They were founded in 2013, but they have worked on some relatively popular franchises like Shinmai Maono Testament and Date Alive. Okay, then let's take a closer look at two of these studios. First, Manglobe, because it's perhaps the most interesting case, because it's the biggest and most well-known one of these. So first, I'll give you a brief history of Manglobe, so we actually know what kind of studio we are talking about. So it all started inside Studio Sunrise. And it's Sunrise is known for also for many animes, but for example for Gundam series and Gintama anime adaptation. So the year was 2002, and two ex-Sunrise producers, Shinichiro Kobayashi and Takashi Kochiyama, decided to establish their own studio, and that was the beginning of Manglobe. And the first major work of Manglobe was an original work, Samurai Champloo, in 2004. And then they have also made Ergo Proxy, as I mentioned earlier. And they have also made many popular adaptations, like The World God Only Knows, and Dead Man Wonderland. Okay, so now we get to the kind of more unpleasant part in the story of Manglobe. So in on September 29th, 2015, Manglobe filed for bankruptcy and removed their web page. They had actually been in debt for a long time already. When they formally started the bankruptcy proceedings on November 4th, they had a debt of 540 million yen. That is around 4.3 million euros. They had their peak sales in year 2013, and it was 1 billion yen. For a comparison, Kyoto Animation and Bones had that year net sales of around 2 billion yen. So twice this, but still this is a lot compared to that. So Manglobe was certainly in the so-called big league. But as you see, next year their net sales dropped sadly under half of the earlier to 460 million yen. So they certainly weren't doing that well anymore. So next, let's take a look at what kind of effects this bankruptcy of Manglobe has had. Okay. So Manglobe's last work was an anime adaptation of manga Gangsta in summer 2015. They were able to air the show normally, but then after releasing two volumes on Blu-ray and DVD, the production committee had to postpone the release of the remaining four discs indefinitely. Well, actually, the discs have been released now, but in the end, they were released 1.5 years after the date they were supposed to be released. Okay, so then there's another work that Manglobe's bankruptcy had even a greater effect on, and it's this, Genocidal Organ. It's a part of a film trilogy based on novels written by author Project Ito. So Manglobe was the studio that was responsible for animating this, and this was scheduled to be to come out in November 2015. And at the time of bankruptcy, the film staff reported that the film was 60% complete. However, one of these film's producers, Koji Yamamoto, revealed later that because they had discovered during the coloring of this film that they had to do a lot of retakes to maintain the quality of the film. He said that the percentage of completion was actually closer to 20, so quite far from the earlier 60. Okay, so to be able to finish this film, this producer, Yamamoto, decided to establish a new animation studio called Geno Studio. And they were able to complete the film in February 2017, but that was already a year after the original release date. So okay. So that's the story for Manglobe. Then the second case study is Artland. And again, some history for Artland. It was founded in 1978 by the now deceased animator Noboru Ishiguro. Here. And as I already mentioned, it's known, for example, for Mushishi and the Legend of the Galactic Heroes, but also they have animated many other different kinds of anime, like Bokura ga Ita. It's a series based on a romantic shoujo manga. And then there's Katekyo Hitman Reborn. It was adapted from an action shonen manga. And Demon King Daimao, it's an ecchi harem series based on a light novel. So many different genres. Okay, so Artland had also been in debt for a while. When the real problems started. So as of December 2016, it had 300 million yen in debt. It's not quite as much as the 500 million yen of Manglobe, but it's not far from it. Okay, so let's then look at the net sales of Artland. So in 2015, the sales were 290 million yen. Again, it's not quite as much as the 1 billion that Manglobe had, but it's still a kind of a respectable amount. And then in year 2016, it dropped like to under one third to 8 million yen, as you see here. So this doesn't look very good at all for them, sadly. But then in June 2016, a savior appeared. A Chinese animation company called Haoliners bought 51% of the stock in Artland in order to restructure the company to be able to boost its anime production capacity. But sadly, this helped Artland only to get so far, because in July next year, a corporate credit research company, Teikoku Data Bank, reported that Artland had filed for bankruptcy and ceased operations earlier that month. But actually, it turns out that this information wasn't entirely correct, because later the president of Artland, Kuniharu Okano, denied this and told that they are actually seeking to consolidate their debts with the help of a Tokyo-based corporate attorney. And here, consolidating a debt means basically that they are seeking to combine all their debts into a single loan, for which they would have more time to pay it. So it would be a better situation for them. But then, in the next month, their savior, Haoliners, sold its ownership stake in Artland after coming to the conclusion that it's too difficult to restructure a Japanese studio from outside. Here, the Imon Animation Company is a Japanese side branch of Haoliners. So basically, it's still Haoliners who bought the stocks and then sold them. Well, these stocks were bought by a Japanese local holding company Levels, so now the threat of bankruptcy has been avoided, at least in the short term. But the situation doesn't still look very good. So we haven't heard after that anything new about the matter, and it has already been 1.5 years. So I guess now only time will tell what will happen to Artland. next, let's also take a closer look what kind of effects this situation of Artland has had to their productions. So their latest production is 7 mortal sins, Shin no Natsu no Taisai. It was aired in the spring of 2017. They had serious problems in the production. They had to do 2 recap episodes in the middle of the 12 episodes long series to have enough time to finish the actual episodes, to be able to broadcast them on TV. And still, nevertheless, the last episode had to be delayed for a week. But in this case, the DVD and Blu-ray releases were on time. And since this, Artland hasn't announced any new projects, and remember, this was in the spring of year 2017. This was even before the bankruptcy speculations. So, yeah. Okay, so now we get to the big questions. Why did these things happen? Let me first correct a common misunderstanding. For example, Manglobe didn't go bankrupt because of this. The sales of their latest shows didn't actually matter that much. But to understand why they then went bankrupt, we have to take a closer look at how funding works in anime industry. Namely, what are production committees and what is the production committee system that is used to fund anime nowadays? In most animes, you see in the end of the end credits this kind of screen. And this is from anime Watamote. So here are listed basically all the companies that participated in funding the anime, and that's what the production committee of an anime is. But let's take a look what kind of companies there are. Okay, first it says in the top that it says Seisaku, which means production, and then it says Watamote Seisaku Inkai, that is Watamote Production Committee in English. And then is the list of the companies. So the first company is Media Factory. It's a distributing company, which means that they sell basically the DVD and Blu-ray discs, and they also sell the streaming rights of the anime to streaming websites. Then is ATX, it's a Japanese television channel. Then Silverlink, it's the animation studio that produced Watamote. Then there's TV Tokyo, it's another TV channel. Then there's Bushiroad, it's a card game company. Good Smile Company, it's a figure manufacturer. Sony Music Communications, it's a music production company. Dax Production, a sound production company. And the last one is Nihon Narration Engi Kenkyu. It's a seiyu training school. It's a bit more unusual company to see in the production committee of an anime. But it's not entirely unrelated to anime, so kind of makes sense. So, then, okay. All the companies don't give an equal amount of money to fund the anime. Basically, the first company listed gives the most money and the second gives second most and so on. So that's worthwhile to notice from these lists. So then why do these companies give money to fund anime? The point is that the production company actually owns the intellectual property related to the show, that is basically the copyrights of the show. So they not only get the money from the DVD and Blu-ray sales of the show, but also from all the merchandise sales as well. So they get basically the most of the money that the anime makes. Okay, then why? Well, actually, let's take a quick look to another example. This is from Usagi Drop. And again, it says the Anime Usagi Drop production committee in the top, and then the companies listed here are Toho, again, a distribution company, Fuji TV, again, TV channel, Sony Music Entertainment, again, and then Dentsu, an advertising company, Production IG, the animation studio that animated Usagi Drop, and Shōdensha, it's the publisher of the manga that this anime is adapted from. Okay, so then why to use production committees at all? Why not just kind of fund the anime by yourself? The obvious reason is that you kind of split the production costs. I mean, it costs a lot to make an anime. So it certainly makes sense to get together many companies that all fund part of it. Okay, and also, of course, it basically splits the risks, because if the anime flops, then the companies lose their money, or at least a lot of money. So if you don't fund the whole anime, then you don't lose as much money if the show flops. And another reason why to use production committee is, well, you see here many different kinds of companies. There's a one for distribution, and then one that produces music, and that one that produces animation, and so on. Basically, even if there was only one company funding the anime, they would have to take care of the distribution and making the music and making the animation. But it's kind of a lot of different things to do for one company. So why not use one specialized company for each of these things? It's more efficient. It's just more efficient. Okay. Then the most important thing to notice from these production committees, for if you think about this lecture, is the animation studios here, because the most of the times animation studios aren't very high in the production committee, and that's because that would take unusually stable finances from them. And also many times they are not in the committee at all. And in these cases, they are usually paid just a fixed amount of money for the series. That's the animation budget of the series. But they won't gain anything more even if the series ends up being crazy popular. So they will. Image about this. So they get the production money from the production budget, but then they don't get any from the disc and merchandise sales. So Manglobe hadn't been in a production committee in a long time, and that is basically the main reason for their financial difficulties. Let's take a look at a couple of examples. This is from Samurai Flamenco, and here are all the companies in the production committee of Samurai Flamenco, and as you see, there's no Manglobe anywhere, sadly. And then here is production committee of Unlimited Psychic Squad. There again, it's animated by Manglobe, but Manglobe is not in the production committee. So then why couldn't Manglobe join any production committee? It's actually very hard to tell, because all negotiations related to these things have happened behind closed doors. And this means that we don't know much about the situation. But I want to speculate a bit anyway. So if you take a look at the typical production committee, as I already mentioned earlier, you see many different kinds of companies. And many of them are to merchandise production, this figure manufacturer and card game company and so on. And some of them are related to some other related stuff, like if there's a manga related to the, if there's a manga that is anime adapted from there, usually is the publisher and such things. So the point is that the most of these kind of companies wouldn't probably be willing to put their money on a totally new original anime from an animation studio, because it doesn't have a manga or novel related to it, so it couldn't kind of boost its sales. There's like not much to gain for these kind of companies. And also, I think usually original anime doesn't sell merchandise as well as adaptations do. So this could basically force the studios to take adaptation projects, and these kind of projects usually already have a strong production committee behind, that it would be very hard for the animation studio to become a significant member of. So then there's also another possibility for why these studios can't join the production committees, because if the studio has unstable finances, like they usually do, at least to some degree, so they could want to avoid any risks, and funding an anime is a big risk because it could flop hard. So they might choose themselves to not fund their animes, like at all, or only fund a small part, like maybe here this could be the case, because Production IG is the second last anyway. But of course, this is a bit counterintuitive, because as I already told you, in the long run, this is just going to do harm on them, because they can't benefit of the sales of the anime at all. But then let's summarize the main points, what are the production committees, how were they related to this lecture, just for a yeah. So the, as I said, production committee gets all the sales profits, and then if the animation studio isn't in the committee, it doesn't benefit of the sales, even if the anime sells well. And in that case, the studio is just paid upfront this fixed budget for the project, and that is all the money they get. Okay, so that's it. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask or comments. Yes.
Yes, one question regarding your first year. In one of the animes, you showed that there's Bushiroad, which is a TCG company in the production committee.
Yeah.
Can we have an example? Because, you know, Bushiroad has a training card game called Wise Watch, and it's basically a card game where there's a bunch of different anime franchises in which they use to produce the card game for different blocks and expansions. Yeah. So, like, when Bushiroad gives money to the anime's production, can they say that, if we give this money, we want all the TCG rights for this particular IP? Is it the only money that they get from the whole thing, is that they get the TCG product, the IP for the TCG, or do they get the profit from the anime overall once they're in the production committee?
Well, I'm not actually sure about the details, but I think it's at least we can say for sure that they get the TCG rights for the anime, but I don't know if they get also part of the sales profits. I mean, I think it depends what kind of agreement they have with the production committee. So, any other questions? Yes.
What's your opinion on, for example, Studio Trigger using Patreon to gain funds for their own animes? They're a mostly original anime studio, mm-hmm. And the producer has said that in every season they're overblowing the budget, and they're trusting Patreon to gain some additional funds. What's your opinion on them using it? Is it sustainable?
Is it sustainable? Well, I mean, I guess as long as they have enough fans that are ready to give their money to them, so I mean, sure. So, any other questions? Nope. Okay, so thank you for coming.